Kent Cheese Company, Valley Cheese Company, Chicago, Illinois. Known him for quite a number of years. I always thought he was a fine gentleman. And I really appreciate you driving all the way from Chicago here. And you brought a friend along, you said? What's his name, Vince?
Bob Levin.
Bob Levin. Yeah. Glad that he came along too.
Definitely company.
All right, here we are at Turner Hall. And it's around 3 o'clock in the afternoon down here at the Lee Shula. And we have Ernie Hall here. He's going to be with us. And we'll see how it turns out, all right?
Time with me.
Okay. All right. Sal, where were you born?
I was born in Chicago. And I was raised in Wheaton, Ohio, just in the suburb west of Chicago.
Which, to us people out here,
still Chicago.
To us, all right. Now, the reason we brought you, I asked you to come up, you know, because your father and your name was so prominent in the Italian dairy industry and in Italian cheese, and Fowler has been almost the name synonymous with cheese. And having done some business with you and met with all of your family, you know, I really take pride that you took the time to drive all the way out here. How did this business start with you down there, the Fowler cheese?
Well, the company started in 1904 by my grandfather, who's I'm named after. And he came here from southern Italy, Calabria region, in the late 1890s, and did a variety of jobs. Worked on the railroad mostly, and like a lot of the immigrants, we didn't really get ahead, but start their own business, you know, they didn't speak the language, or, you know, couldn't get ahead. So he knew how to make cheese from when he was a young man in Italy. And so he started actually originally in the kitchen of the apartment when he first got married, would make a little bit of cheese. And then this was on the west side, near west side of Chicago. And then moved over to another Italian neighborhood, Miller Street. There made cheese in the basement. He'd buy a few cans of milk and go from there to make cheese in the basement, and then he would go out originally on foot, and then eventually would go some way, would go to the door and sell the cheese.
Now, do you think it was kind of a mozzarella type, or do you think just it was kind of maybe a cheese?
No, mostly at that time he made the ricotta cheese.
Yeah,
you know,
okay, just took the whole thing.
Lasagna and cheese juice for lasagna, raviolis and that. And then from there made some mozzarella. And those were the two main items that made the company.
Okay, can you explain a little bit about the ricotta? So, what you call it, ricotta?
Ricotta, which in Italian would mean like recooked. Ricotta is usually made from, the traditional way would be you make a mozzarella and then you would take the whey that was left over, add some milk to that, and then you acidify it with acetic acid. White vinegar is what, you know, what it is. Some people use a citric acid or other, but you acidify it with one of those acids, cooked it up to a high temperature, and then the curds would fall to the top. They'd be skimmed off and drained, and that's what I thought was manufactured.
You just went around there, around the street, and peddled it, right?
Right. Yeah. In those days, without refrigeration, you pretty much had to do it every day. They didn't even make cheese in the summertime in those days because they couldn't keep it cold.
And the milk you bought from, they had some farmers there or through a company or?
I don't know how he bought it. In those days in Chicago, he would have been buying cans from somebody, but I don't know. It would not have been direct from a farmer. Now, what he did then, in the 1920s, he went out and bought land in Wheaton, which, like I said, is a suburb of about 25 miles straight west of Chicago. That was all farm area, and he built a factory there. And then they bought milk directly from the farms in that area, and made the mozzarella and the ricotta.
So it started with almost like a little home operation.
Mm-hmm.
And when did it really start expanding? 20s, 30s?
Well, you know, again, it's all before my time, but it was a steady growth, I think, as the kids came along, he had, I think originally he had 11 kids, a few of them died in childbirth, but 10 of them, or 12, I think, and then 10 of them grew. So he had four sons. My father was the second son, but as the sons came along, and they got into business, and they went out, and they kind of grew with the Italian community in Chicago. So it was, you know, probably was a pretty steady thing over the years. The big boom, of course, then came in the late 50s with pizza, and the mozzarella became more popular.
Can you, the first names, can you remember the first names of your uncles?
Yeah, the oldest one was Fred, and his name was Fortunato. We called him Fred. He was the oldest son. He was born in 1904. My father was Frank. He was born in 1912, and the two younger boys were Henry and Joe. I'm not sure what years they were born, but there's.
I remember your father and Fred.
Right.
But yeah, those were two younger guys at all.
But as the boys came along and they took over the business, my grandfather died in 1944, and then the four sons took over it at that point. And they had moved to a couple other locations in Chicago as the business expanded and as it moved.
Which, like you say, in the 50s now, the pizza, it was a kind of limited, more or less, to the Italian ethnic group?
Up until that time, yeah. I mean, our business was always primarily the ricotta cheese, which went through pretty much the Italian market in Chicago, at least the store. Chains, but that was always our principal item. The mozzarella, of course, grew, as pizza became more popular.
And it's like the ricotta, like you said, the name is, the Italian is called ricotta,
yeah.
which means that you heat it up so high that, or like take the whey and recook it, and put in this acid, and then brings out some more solids, right?
Exactly. Yeah, we're getting more solids than that.
That's left to it. Those are cheeses that none of them I had really heard of in my life. And the Italian, really with their recipes and their ingenuity and their ethnic recipes that they had for cooking and whatnot. Now we have Parmesan or Romano, mozzarella, pizza, all kinds of lasagna dishes. It's really been a boom.
Sure.
The dairy industry really has really helped. I think pizza is about the second, isn't it? I don't just know.
Yeah, I'm away from the business now. Sure, it's probably right behind the hamburger. I think it's a popular.
I had never ever heard of pizza until my wife was in the nurse training. She was in the Chicago area.
Yeah.
And when I went to Rockford, I had a pizza, the natural ways. And I didn't just know at that time whether I really liked it or not. And God, I ended up here. It's been my business.
And I can remember most of the time growing up. A lot of people kept saying it's a fad and it's going to pass, and it's never going backwards yet.
Yeah, well, I know it's because of course everything was Swiss here. And, well, I don't know, what time did you go to Kent? Where did you feel it?
They bought the plant in Kent in 1954 or 1955, somewhere in that range. At that time, owned by Borden, but they had shut it down for some reason. They hadn't been operating for a while. And so they bought it and then proceeded to go out and find milk in the area and develop the business.
Yes, it's been quite a boom to the industry. Just when we're recording here, I can say a few things. Like, we started to switch from Swiss cheese to mozzarella back in 62. The dealers said, just like you said, Sal, and it's just bad. And even Kraft, I don't think, got into it for about 3 or 4 years later after we did, And of course, Kraft being a big part of the major industry was supposed to know that the future and everything, but it just wasn't a fad. It came and it spread from the strong sausage to plain old pork sausage out in Iowa. But by the way, it went.
My father said that one of the, it was actually a stumbling block in trying to get milk into that plant, because when they go out and try and, you know, solicit farmers for the milk, and ask what you're going to do, or what kind of cheeses you made, and if they started telling them we're about for mozzarella, they didn't know what it was, they didn't think that plant was going to be around very long, so all they would, after a while, all they said was we make foreign type cheeses, and you know, that was okay, but then you get specific, because people couldn't see the future in that.
And, all right, now, Kent, was, you say that plant was closed when you came?
Yeah. Yeah, and I don't know how long it had been closed. It was a year or two. It wasn't a real great long amount of time, but a man by the name of Gus Krapp had originally built that plant, to my knowledge, and I don't know at what point he sold it to Borden's, and Borden's operated for quite a few years, again, going back before my time, but part of that plant, or the boiler area of that plant, was built by the German prisoners of war during the Second World War. They had a camp out in that area somewhere, and they built that.
Well, when did you start getting involved in when you had your dairy background? Or
I can probably remember some things back to when I was maybe only 5 or 6 years old, because shortly after I was born, the factory in Wheaton burnt to the ground. They had to rebuild it. My grandfather wanted somebody out there, so my parents agreed to go out and live in Wheaton near the plant for a year or so, and never left. But, so I grew up literally about 100 yards away from the cheese factory, and at that time, the mozzarella cheese was made in a couple of different forms. One of them they called scamorza, and it was, they were handmade, you know, as all the pasta velata types were hand molded.
Now, what was the shape of this?
It was kind of a pear shape, and it had a little bit of a head on it. And what they used to do with those is the stores would, what we used to do is you'd tie a little string around it, almost like a noose type of thing, and you had two of them on a string, and the stores would hang those from hooks.
And they worked with the pear ring, or would
you? No, they would just develop a little skin as they dry a little bit. It was even within, you know, a week or so after it was made, but they'd get a little bit of skin. So what we used to do at night was sit around and tie strings for the cheese. So I don't remember how we did that anymore, but I know as a little kid, I used to know how to tie those strings. And then, you know, so I don't know that I could pick a time that I say I went to work, or it just seemed like that's what I was.
That's what you started.
Where I went into it as a kid, it was fun to go over there, and so I was probably in somebody's way most of the time.
It's kind of interesting because, you know, today you don't even have to tie your shoes. They got right. This backward or all backward.
Well, we thought it was a big step up when they came out with the little icing bags, and then we didn't have to do that anymore. We could just put them in the bag.
Is there much scamorza around? I'm not in the stores that much.
No, because I think it really got lost with packaging. As you packaged it, you didn't get that skin on it anymore, and it wasn't any different than the other mozzarella was, and so it, because they were made from the same curd. So, no, you probably still see some cheeses with that label on them, but it's not going to be any different than the mozzarella.
Well, then when you went to Kent, the farmers, who went out to see them, and did you hire who made the cheese, or did you get somebody from around here, or?
At the time they bought the plant, there was a man by the name of Chris Peepers that had worked with Borden's and still lived there. They hired him. He was a plant manager. And I think most of the milk that they got was probably with the help of some of the co-ops, pure milk at that time. Somewhere in the early 60s, we brought a man, Fran Dahl, who came and was the manager for many years.
Do you recall what top production was?
Probably about 150 to 180,000 pounds of milk a day. That was probably about the peak when I was there.
And then the 60s came along there. 70s, everybody's.
Yeah, it was just a continuous, continuous growth. But the kind of things that, you know, I guess I'm just old enough to remember before, you know, we got into all the equipment that we have today. So, you know, I was a couple of years younger, I probably would have missed some of that, but I still remember all the hand.
The hand bowling?
Well, the hand bowling, and we used to make the curd by hand. We used to use had a big wooden tub, we'd get strips of curd, put the hot water in.
Oh, is that right? With
yeah.
The paddle?
Yeah, we'd use like an axe handle kind of thing, and that's it. You kept stirring that, stress.
Yeah, maybe kind of just describe that a little bit. Like the wash tub, wooden tub.
Right.
And the water in there is approximately hot water, 180.
About as hot as you could put your hands in, you know, or hotter than you could get your hands in, because you're still hitting the mold. So you have about 180 degree water, and then that would, that we'd cut the curd in the strips, and then with that axe handle, just keep stirring and mixing.
Something like stretch tap.
Like, exactly, yeah, more like a tapping type of a thing. And then when that curd was smooth, and then you
I got a chuckle. You got to put that stretch in there. See?
Right.
This one of the deputies says to me, when you take a bite of the pizza, and she knows the stretch and snap back and hit you in the nose, and she's a no good.
That's right.
You know? And of course, then this Milwaukee cheese comes along here, and they made cheese this slinky over here. I forget what they developed the cheese by brick.
Right.
It didn't have that stretch.
Right.
I went down to Rockford trying to sell my mozzarella. They didn't want it at all. They said they wanted it so they could take a bite.
Yeah.
Take a bite, and then it didn't have all that stretch. I had a heck of a time trying to sell cheese down there. It just went down. And all of us Pizza Hut come along with an advertisement of that stretch, and everything changed just like that. I just want to kind of think how the industry changes.
No, it has. It's changed with people's taste, because I can remember in one, number one had better stretch, and number two, the pizza maker wanted to see a little pool of oil on top of that pizza. It had to be a high-fat cheese for the flavor. And of course, that doesn't, you know, that doesn't work anymore either. But unless you had some butterfat dripping down your chin, it wasn't a good, good piece of pizza.
Well, that's a change of the eating right. Habits. All right, now you not only had the plant there, and in Chicago, then Wheaton, what did you have down there? Warehouses then?
Well, in Wheaton, they made cheese. Like I said, my grandfather went there in the 20s, and they continued to make cheese there until the late 50s. And then about 1958, 1959, somewhere in there, they closed the plant in Wheaton. They built a new building in Melrose Park, you know, another suburb of Chicago, and they combined the factory in Wheaton and the distribution and the warehouses that were in Chicago there in Melrose Park. So everything was under one roof. And we continued to make cheese in Melrose Park probably until like the mid to late 60s, somewhere in that range. And it just wasn't practical to bring the milk in there any longer, doing it there. So at that point, then all the production was out of Kent.
Kent Cheese Company, or Kent, Kent is what? How far from Monroe South would you say? 3 miles?
Probably about 25 miles south, and then probably about another 15 miles west, I guess. Or I guess you'd go to Niagara.
From Monroe, yeah. I give an idea to somebody that's watching this interview where the fact is located.
Yeah, about 15 or 18 miles straight west of Freeport.
All the milk that every day you take the trucks going into Chicago or
right. Yeah, we had a truck to 5 days a week.
Now are you kind of are you ever in the crust business too, or to the extent of it?
We in the 1960s we got in the pizza crust business. And then mostly in our case most of our customers were small frozen pizza manufacturers that did not make their own crust or in areas other than Chicago, pizza places would buy that frozen crust to make pizzas. Most of the pizza operations in Chicago did their own. You know, they made their own dough and all their own. But yeah, that was.
Well, did you have delivery routes then and trucks in Chicago, or how did you sell?
Yeah, for the cheese we did. We used to do store door delivery to the entertainment stores, a lot of the pizzerias. We sold them, you know, the cheeses as well as the pizza supplies. The larger chains were warehouse just drop deliveries. But yeah, we had several routes that we did around the street.
So now there was your uncles, and are they any of them living anymore?
No, they're all deceased at this point. The youngest died probably about 4 or 5 years ago. The oldest one just died a few years ago.
Is there anybody at the family at all left in your?
I have one aunt that that's the rice from that family. She was the youngest of the girls. And she was just 78.
Okay, Sal, when did you get married?
I got married in 1970.
And then you children?
Yeah, I have a daughter who's now 26 and a son that's 23.
And those in the dairy industry?
No, because I sold my interest in the business some years back, and
And when did you sell out here?
I sold my interest in the company in 1984.
Is it that long?
Yeah.
But the dairy business has been very good to you, right?
Well, no complaints. I wouldn't be here without it. But my grandfather did what he did when he did. No, it was I enjoyed the industry. It was a good industry, and I still like it. I think all the time I was, a lot of good people. I enjoyed working with, I enjoy farmers.
You kind of get a little camaraderie, even myself, when I would see your father and your brother at the Marshall seminar or something, where they get together, whether it is, well, that's our neighbor over there, neighbor cheesemaker, be a competitor, but yet, friction or whatever,
no.
You felt that bond, that camaraderie, there is no achievement there.
No, those are the things I remember most from the fond memories that you have is that, again, while you were in competition, most people were pretty easy to get along with, there was a mutual respect. They enjoyed farmers, they were, you knew where you stood with them, they did what they were supposed to do, they were honest people, and, as opposed to, you're in a family position, you do a little bit of everything, and I was much happier dealing with the other plant operators or farmers as opposed to the customers. The customers were always, that was always the
hardest part. They're always working for an extra penny,
right?
It becomes a challenge there. Who were your competitors in Chicago then?
Well,
in
the regard to business, there was, all the time that I remember, they would have started sometime after my grandfather did, but the two companies that made the regard to the area were the Mancuso Cheese Company in Joliet and the Cholino Cheese Company in Joliet, and they still exist. The families are still there. But again, even then, there were people we got along with well. Respected each other's customers, and I think always had a good relationship with each other. But they were the two major manufacturers of Borgata. And the mozzarella business, once the pizza boom started, the competition was everybody and anybody that that was in the business.
Today, I guess you'd call it a commodity product. Some factories that went into pizza or mozzarella, as we say, or piece of cheese, and they're already out of it. It's pretty hard to compete. And now they can ship it from California or from other places, and 3-4 cents, and then the price of milk spreads almost a dime when it comes in here.
The things that I started to see before I got out of the business and see more of now, we were talking about earlier, is that, probably because the markets have gotten larger, they've gotten more competitive, that things started to get more standardized in a lot of the cheeses, and you lost that, you lost the customer who wanted the little differences, when it was
standard. One that didn't brown, one that was
standard. Yeah, they all had to, but if someone bought your cheese, they bought it because they wanted your, the way you manufactured it. There's not much of that left anymore. It's all, in most of the varieties, they've become standardized. And again, I guess there's, probably some pluses with that, but it was, a little bit of the business that got lost.
You made some Romano and Parmesan down here.
We made some Romano and Parmesan, and we made provolone also. And some varieties there. Provolone we made on a regular basis. The Romano and Parmesan we generally made in the spring, early summer. The flesh area. But yeah, we made those, and most of that we cured and distributed ourselves.
How long would you age that Romano?
Anywhere from 6 to 9 months.
And Parmesan?
Pretty much about the same. And the provolone, depending on the variety. We made the 12 pounds, which is more for slicing the sandwiches. That was a mild cheese. Those cure about 30 to 60 days. But we then used to make some larger types that, where we had added enzymes and got a separate flavor, and those would be in 6 months.
And the enzymes, the original cheese of Parmesan, Romano, and provolone, most of those in Europe were made with sheep's milk, right? Goat's milk, right?
The Romano, the Parmesan is, the name Parmesan comes from the Parma region, really, and that's more of a cow's milk area. So Parmesan in Italy is generally made with the cow's milk. The Romano was made with sheep milk. So of course in this country you don't have the sheep milk, the goat milk, and we would add that
enzyme
to more or less, yeah,
that's what I wanted to bring out.
Get that type of flavor out.
Well, when I grew up, all at once I saw a sausage hanging up, Then I finally got all at once I making mozzarella, Italian cheese, and meeting some Italian people, and they had their cheese strung up. What kind of cheese is that? Talk about tiny knots. That must be an art in itself. You can describe one of them old. And what did they call them, round ones? I know what the slang name is.
Yeah, they were all provolone family, but there was, provolone but it was a small provolone. There were provolones. There were
like way what?
There were provolettes. Boccini, which Bocci was, meaning like a ball shape. That was
ball.
Yeah. So,
usually they were hanging, right? They on a net. And
yeah, provolones were always on. And
did you ever smoke them in the smokehouse?
Yeah, we did not do that at Kent. Somewhere in between there, like in the early 60s through early 70s, we had a small plant in Dane County, Wisconsin. And they bought that. Partially learned how to make the provolones and that the operator was doing there, and plus some extra production. And there they used a small one. They tied in there and they had a small house. Okay, so it was an old plant built in the hill. It was smoke. By the time we were doing them in Kent, then we didn't have a small house there.
We had liquid smoke. Well, it's all out for you. You got a family that's raised 23, and you're living in, you say, Wheat yet?
That isn't going on, which is still in the area.
Well, listen, it's nice visiting with you, Sal.
Thank you. I do appreciate this.
And I'm going to take you over there and give you a little tour of the center.
Okay.
All right?
Good. That sounds good.
And thanks for bringing that bottle along.
All right.
You look like a jolly fellow.
Thank you.